Well, the funniest thing just happened. I just recorded a video. Certainly one of the best I've ever recorded, and put tremendous effort into it. A long video, hour and a half at least. Just covering everything I needed to cover. And I'm telling everyone to just, you know, give a tremendous effort right now. And spare no effort. It's so important to keep on keeping on. And my basic message was, you know, let's double our efforts right now, and get everything we need to get. And so I went to upload it, and eventually I realized I had forgotten to press record on the camera. I was busy adjusting the light levels and forgot to press record. So here I am now, having to double down on my efforts and follow it up with another video. So I got the benefit of making the video, and now I get the benefit of making another. So I have to follow my own advice here. Went out to the curb. I put the garbage out at the curb today. Went back to get something in the backyard. Came back out and where the garbage was. And I saw this deluge, as it were, coming down the gutter from up the street. I said, what is that? And it was this mass of water coming down the gutter. There's no rain here. You know, it's totally dry. I said, what's going on here? And then I realized it was going to hit the garbage can. It was against the curb. And then the very last instant, I grabbed the can and pulled it away from the curb, and the deluge swept by the garbage can like that. And the garbage can was untouched. Just one instant more, it would have, you know, hit the side of the garbage can, hit the wheels of the garbage can, and created a mess kind of thing. And just so I realized, you know, sometimes that good timing can be like right at the instant, right? You just barely avoid it. Close call. And I feel that with the world, this is the situation we're in. We're in a situation where the sidestepping will be a very narrow escape. Well, it has to be at this time. It has to be. Very narrow escape. Now, I read all these explanations from different great teachings, etc. And they're all different in various different ways, okay? Fine. I happen to like the explanation that the Holy Spirit has given me. Much prefer it. So when I read, I just bought a book today, Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell. I bought that book in 1984, and I lost it like in 2005, I think. It's somewhere, I don't know what happened to it. And so I said, oh, good, let me get it again. And I was reading it, and it's like, it doesn't quite fit. I just don't quite like it like I used to. It's no, I don't, it's not exactly my cup of tea. And then I'm reading I Am That by Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj. And again, I say, well, it's very good. It's nice. It's not quite my cup of tea. And on and on and on with everything I see now, it's not quite it. It's not quite my cup of tea. The explanation that I'm giving here for me is way better, for me at least. It's my cup of tea. You know, if you want a cup of tea the way you really want it, you need to make your own cup of tea, I would say. I call it the billion-year baby shower. The billion-year baby shower. In the last video that I just didn't record, you look at this existence again as what I, the way I see it, is existence is the attempt of spirit, which is the Son of God, to create something separate from God, to have a separate creation, so it, spirit, can claim that it's the prime creator and not God. Or it's a new prime creator, that it's attained prime creator status because it's able to create something of its own creation, not an extension of the will of God, but its own creation. So, actually, spirit can't do this, but it can prepare for, as if it could. You see, there's nothing stopping spirit from pretending that it could, but preparing for it. So what spirit's doing is preparing for this creation. It says that it's not ready yet. We need to prepare for it. And so all time and space is a projection of spirit, projection of mind, in order to prepare a past for this supposed new creation. the separate creation, so that the separate creation can look at all time and space, everything that's happened there, and think that that's where it came from. That's its reality. And will never suspect that it actually is an extension of spirit. And so spirit will think that it's created something that doesn't acknowledge or even know its creator, and thus is a new creation. See, different than how God creates. I've covered that in previous videos. So we're waiting for this child to be born. We're waiting for our child to be born. And so we've been having this baby shower, a billion-year baby shower, actually many billions of years. We'll call it the billion-year baby shower, where everything we've done, we spared no effort to try and concoct all these clothings and gifts and accoutrements of a baby, a little infant, to give to this infant, to convince it that it didn't come from us. It came from time and space. It didn't come from spirit. It's not spiritual. It's time and space. It's flesh. It's a thing. It doesn't have being. It's not a being. It's a thing. It's a process. That's where it came from, process. So imagine if we had a baby shower for an infant, and everybody comes and brings all their gifts. So many gifts, and they're just showering gifts in readiness for the baby to arrive. And so all the gifts are contained in this, in the house. But the baby never arrives. Never arrives. Then what use is all these gifts? What use is it? There's no child, no baby. They're not suitable for us. This world is not suitable for us, for spirit. Totally unsuitable. And for me, I have zero interest in it, in the world. From the level of spirit, nothing really interests me. He says, what is this? This is for a child of flesh, you know, not for me. But we have spent all this effort. And I can remember my own incarnations of, as far as spirit incarnating in this world to work on gifts. Spirit incarnates bodies for one reason, is to work on all these gifts. There's one level of working on it. So we can bestow these gifts upon the child, like frankincense and myrrh, the child is born, divine child, we all come and bestow gifts on the child. Well, I spent lifetimes, like last life, I spent an entire life slaving away, trying to make the most beautiful music possible for the child to be born. We symbolize this as the Christ child. We think there's a child that's going to be born into time and space. And so we're trying to get ready for this, for this birth. And so I really made this superhuman effort to create the most incredibly beautiful music possible, and had it recorded and written, and you know, and all for this child. You see, we're all working for this child. All bodies, all human, all worlds, everything's working for this child to be born in time and space. So that when the child is born, they'll have all these gifts and they'll think, ah, this is all there for me. This is where I came from. Not realizing it was spirit that did all this ahead of time for it. And the kicker is there isn't ever going to be any child born of time and space. So all these efforts that we've made are all for naught. All for naught. And the previous video, I went through all this very heavy remorse and just very glum and down, because it hits so hard. It hits so hard. I feel a little better now. I went through a little depression there for a little while after the video. I'm kind of depressed, but that's why the mood of repentance is so important, to absorb the shock of realizing, oh my gosh, I've wasted all my time, totally wasted all my time, all for nothing. I've done all of this imagining work for nothing. We all expect there's going to be, God is, you know, a divine child to be born in time and space, and say, like, ah, this is my home. This is my home. I recognize my home. This is where I came from flesh, from biology, chemistry, energy, working, all that stuff. I came from this. And we'll keep waiting for that. It will never happen. It will never happen. We wait in vain. We wait entirely in vain. And we work in vain, we strive in vain, we try to we're having this billion-year baby shower where we've just been piling up all this history and gifts and everything. And say, this is all yours, child. All you need to do is accept it all. That this is your home. This is what gave birth to you. And not recognize your true creator. Because once you refuse to recognize your true creator, we spirit can say, aha, we have created new life different than what God creates. We are the new prime creator. We create a life that doesn't recognize its creator, that is separate from its creator. So that is why the world is the way it is. We're trying to generate a world that is utterly different than reality. The catastrophes, the whole world is just a catastrophe, actually. For me, I look at the world, all I see is catastrophe. That's it. It's just different speeds of catastrophe. Everything is catastrophe here. There's absolutely nothing of this world or universe that I would want or to keep. Nothing. It's all 100% a catastrophe. You know, the sun's gonna, burn out at, several billion years, whatever. It's catastrophe, right? It's just a slower, the time frame is slower. Some things go real fast, catastrophe, and it dies. I'm going to catastrophe and dead fast. Other things slower. A little moth is flickering around here, and maybe in 10 days it'll be dead, gone. Catastrophe for it, you see. Nothing but a catastrophe. So we're trying to present this complete catastrophe to our child, and we're trying to have it so long, billions and billions of years of this, that they say that's all there is. It's been going on forever. So it must be eternal. It's been going on forever, billions and billions and billions of years. But how many years is eternal? We have to ask ourselves this question. How many years is actually eternal? 10 billion, 100 billion, trillion? Is that eternal? Maybe after a trillion years we'll think, yeah, that's enough. But if something's born of eternal life, isn't it going to say, hey, wait a minute, this is still time. A trillion years is just as much time as 1 second is time. I'm eternal life. What does time have to do with me? Nothing. So we keep piling on the history, the past. Every moment we use to generate the past here. We see nothing but the past. We work on nothing but the past. We're generating a past to convince our supposed hoped-for child that this is where it came from, this is its home. It's nothing but catastrophe, what we're working with, our imagination. 100%. We want it to be totally opposite. We want it to bear no resemblance to reality whatsoever. None. So our child would get no inkling of reality. Would say, hey, wait a minute. I see this, and I see this, and I kind of like this one better. So maybe, how come I don't like this as much as this? And start thinking, right? It's like, we don't want that. We want it to bear no resemblance. And yet we don't want it to be so unattractive that the child will say, wow, this is very unattractive. So there's little decorations that we're making, but it's all catastrophe. It's all catastrophe. It's all doom. The entire universe is nothing but doom. Intentionally, that's what we're doing. Intentionally. That inherently is the way it is when we want our projections to become a separate creation, a separate will. Separate will. You see, that's it. We're trying to split will. Cannot do it. Will is unsplittable. Will of God is unsplittable. We cannot create a separate creation that is a separate will. But we believe that we can if we just get enough terrible history accumulated that will be convincing enough that we think that this, our projections will say, hey, wait a minute, I didn't come from spirit, I'm not a projection, I'm actually coming from this history here. And it never works. It never works. So if we don't realize this, we'll stay on another billion-year baby shower. We'll go another billion years accumulating these so-called gifts and working on our talents, trying to make beautiful artwork and culture and music and lives and everything for this child, just for the child. It's not for us. Again, like I take the whole world. There's a song that say, take the world but give me Jesus. Exactly. Take the whole world, take the whole universe. I could care less about it. Totally care less about it. It's not for me. It's not for me. It's not for what I am at all. It has nothing, it doesn't suit me at all. Just like a, you know, clothing and for an infant, what an infant would want. We get all these little things for an infant. It doesn't suit the parent. We have a baby shower and all this stuff for the infant. The infant never arrives. What are the parents going to do with all this stuff? It's not for them. It doesn't suit them. This universe doesn't suit me at all, spirit at all. I don't see that in the slightest. It's being imagined for this imaginary child. But imaginary child is never born, actually. Never becomes real. It's always still just imagination. So we're working on this with bodies, you know, these imaginary births, bodies, people, and trying to, these are like testing. We're doing testing. Testing it out for the eventual child that will, we believe, the eventual child will be born from all our testing, which will be the divine child. And they will say, look and say, it is good. I see what created me. I am creation of all this imagination, of all this catastrophe, of all this doom. This is my home. This is what I am. I don't have any connection with anything else. Waste of time. All our time is wasted time. All our time is wasted time. And this is the heavy realization that I went through in the video, which I failed to record. I'm feeling better now, but you know, so I can tell you that just in a matter of hours, you can bounce back from it. I allowed this regret, remorse, foolishness, silly, what an idiot, you know. I've just been imagining there's no such thing as being, where in fact everything is being, always. And we spent billions of years imagining there's no such thing as being, so that we could imagine that such a place could exist for this child that we want to create, so it has no inkling of being either. All the while, everything is being the entire time. Yeah, how stupid is that? Right. So it gives us this feeling like, oh my gosh. Anyway, you know, a couple hours of very feeling just this, wow, heavy. But it was okay. It was all fine. And then I got a little depressed after that, trying to read these other teachings. And I said, they're not saying anything like what I'm talking about here. It's kind of depressing. But, you know, I shook that off. And now I feel a lot better and don't feel so down about it. Okay. They actually are saying something similar. It's just not being put in the same context, actually. And I don't relate well to the context that they presented in. So what I'm stuck, or do I have to present this context, which for me really answers the problem, the questions that I want to have answered. Really, why is the world the way it is? Why is all this tragedy? There's nothing but tragedy here. Really, you look at it and people lead desperate lives. I mean, we don't know what's going on in people's minds, but for myself, I appear to have lived just a normal life. Everything, nothing's wrong, but I've lived the most terrible, atrocious, desperate life imaginable. Nobody even responds as if everything's fine. And I guarantee you, there's a lot of people like that who have led a life of tremendous suffering. And nobody really is even aware of it or even cares or seems to notice it. It's just the craziest thing ever, right? People lead desperate lives. Lives of desperation. Silent scream, you know. I call our lives the silent scream. Because spirit hates this. Hates this unawareness of being. Hates it. And it pushes it, this consciousness keeps trying to experiment with consciousness. Which is just the consciousness again, hates this. It's just this so terrible, desperate, silent lives of desperate, silent screams. So much insecurity, so much vying and competition and conflict and desperation and loneliness, alienation. Worry, concern, you know, just it goes on and on and on. Nobody's honest about it. and we're supposed to make happy here for our child. You know, like we're supposed to say, oh yeah, this world's great, I love this world. And we think if we just learn to love this world, then the child will be born, right? Yeah, I love doom, I love catastrophe. And then that'll automatically trigger the birth of this child. We think there's a mechanism that automatically triggers. Once all of this deception is prepared, then and is effective, then the child will automatically be born. Never happens. So we're stuck continually trying to smile about doom and catastrophe. Everything in the universe gets destroyed. Everything. And so no matter what is made, it's going to be destroyed. You might say the universe isn't simply producing doom. That's all it does is produce doom. That's not reality. That's not my reality. That's not my reality at all. It doesn't interest me in the slightest bit. So it's all being done to try and deceive the child we want to create. A child that doesn't recognize its own, you know, its creator, right? And so, the mood of repentance enables us to see this, and really, it does produce this deep feeling of like, oh my gosh. But it's so, we've been engaged in such an absurdity that spirit can laugh at it, actually. It doesn't destroy spirit. Seeing this does not, the more clearly I see it, it doesn't destroy me. It just makes me stronger. I just feel like, wow, that's pretty funny, actually. What a joke we've been playing on ourselves, right? It's such a huge joke. Spirit can appreciate that humor. See, spirit is so completely unlimited that it, you know, something like this, it can appreciate, get a good laugh out of it. Oh my gosh, you know, look what I've been doing. I've been ignoring being all this time. And preparing for a child that will be born without any being into a world, a universe with no being. What an absurdity, what folly, what a joke, what a prank, what a prank. And so there is some humor along with the like, wow. It's stunning. The realization is stunning. There's a shock, a stun to it, and you feel kind of stunned, spiritually stunned. Like, holy cow. See, we think it's going to work. And once it works, we're going to be happy. See, spirit believes this is all going to work. Once it works, that spirit feels it's going to be prime creator. The proof, the evidence is there. And it'll be eternally, like, totally fulfilled. No more problems. The only problem spirit thinks is that the child hasn't been born yet, because we have not yet concocted a clever enough, convincing enough past for it. See? But this is an endless trap, isn't it? Because there isn't going to be any birth of any child. But as long as we say that the lack of the birth of this child is due to our lack of proper preparation of creating this sufficient mirage for the child, we'll keep on working on the mirage. Can you see that? This is the insidiousness of the whole thing. But it's not. We can easily see it. As long as we have this magical belief that the birth of the child, we can do it, but it's being held up because we don't have a convincing enough mirage. As long as we believe that, we will keep working on the mirage. And we will justify it to ourselves by saying, well, we just haven't worked on it long enough or intensely enough or cleverly enough or beautifully enough. We have to work on it more. It's always more. We have to work on it more. And there's no end to that within this magical belief, is there? None. Because there never will be a birth of the child. And so all we're left with is saying, well, I guess I haven't worked on it long enough. Because again, the belief is, as soon as we complete the mirage where it's going to be effective and convince the child that this is where it came from, then the child will automatically be born. This is our magical belief that we've told ourselves. We simply made this up. We made it up. There isn't any such dynamic. But we're convinced this is the law of God. It's not a law of God. We completely made it up, arbitrarily made this up, so our desire could have an expression. Our desire to be prime creator so it could have an expression. We said, yeah, there's a law of God that as soon as we create this mirage that's convincing enough, automatically the child will be born and it'll be a separate creation. We simply have made this up. Just simply asserted it. It's not true. It's not true. There isn't going to be any birth. There never will be a birth. And so the mirage is useless. We've been working all this time uselessly. But again, the insidiousness of this is to not be aware of why we're working on it, and that we've arbitrarily simply declared there's a law of God that once the mirage gets convincing, the child will be born. There's no such law. It will never happen. So we don't need to keep working on the mirage. But without that realization, we will continue, for sure. We will simply say, well, the child hasn't been born yet, but that's my fault. I haven't worked on it enough. I need to give it another go, another cycle, and let's put it more intense. Let's work on it for another billion years here, and then it'll work. No, after another billion years, you're in the exact same predicament as before. Still no child, still blaming yourself. You haven't worked on it long enough. We need to create a longer past. So the child will look and say, I see a trillion years, and it's all the same doom. Wow, trillion years of doom. And child will say, wow, that must be where I came from then. And then, no, still no child after a trillion years of doom. How about, a trillion years of doom? So again, just make the mirage longer, right? More mirage, more cowbell, come on. And so this is what the insidious trap we're in. But we get out of it by just repentance, realizing, holy cow, there never was any child. It's a false pregnancy. No pregnancy, no gestation, no child. The mirage doesn't matter at all. It's all for nothing. All for nothing. And so what do we do with the mirage? What do we do with the mirage? That is the question, right? What do we do with the mirage? That's the question, right? What do we do with this mirage? What do we do with these billions of years of doom? Of doom. Of doom. Of death. Everything that arises dies. Turns into dust. Dust to dust. Billions of years of doom. What do we do with it, this mirage? That was designed to be nothing like reality. Designed to give a completely false impression. Designed to completely deceive. We've now deceived ourselves in working on this mirage so long. The workers on the mirage have now taken this mirage to be real, So, but seeing now that, now I see why I've been doing this. What folly. What grand folly, really. It's grand folly. It's not little folly. It's grand folly. But spirit can laugh at that and say, oh, gosh, yeah, that is truly grand folly. That is my folly. See, spirit can own that. The little stuff spirit cannot own. It cannot. It's not interested. When you talk about a grand folly like this, spirit can say, yeah, that must be me. That's me. Mea culpa. Mea culpa. I did it. I must have done that. Must be me. And then it can have kind of a last, say, oh my gosh, okay, what do we do? Okay. It's not helpless. Say, okay, got this mirage, this vast mirage, what do we do? And that's where the teachers come in and they tell us, vision of holiness, vision of oneness, and all this kind of stuff, which is just words to people. And we need to look at it more carefully. And that's what we do here. What do we do with this mirage? Oh my gosh, no child's coming, no child, no birth, nothing, 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 nothing. It's all for nothing. Well, we can use it to remind us of reality. We can use it to remind us of reality. That's God's use of the mirage. That's our use of it. That's the Holy Spirit's use of it. Use it to, but how do we let doom, which is really all there is, in this dream, it's just all doom, nothing but doom. How do we How does it remind us of reality in which there's no doom at all? And that's the question that everybody has, like, oh my gosh. And these are the answers that we come up with. And we could say the answer over and over and over and over and over, and still it doesn't quite seem to quite cover it. We say, but how can it cover everything? How can it cover all the past, the present, and the future? Because all this doom is still like the sun's going to blow out in billions of years. That's doom in the future, right? There's doom happening now. There's doom that's happened in the past. There's doom that's going to happen in the future. So how do I cover all doom, all this whole mirage that I've imagined? So it reminds me of reality, is the question. And the answer is the vertical, see the one relationship, and everything is it. The one relationship with pure presence, with omnipresence. Being. See, the being, realize there's nothing but being. Everything is in relationship with everything right now. and that reminds us of reality, actually. In fact, it is reality, but it's the way it's being presented to us. It will remind us of reality, the one relationship. So that is never affected by the doom. The doom doesn't affect that fact at all. It's an eternal, present fact, and it's hard to explain this, really. It's always inadequate, no matter how it's explained. But we can get pretty close to it by looking at it. It's enough to know, yeah, there is an answer for sure. When we see it, I've had a couple glimpses of it, it's like obvious, like, oh, of course this solves the problem. It's like that. You see it instantly, that this is the remedy. It solves all the whole problem, the whole thing of doom. It's solved. The mirage now reminds me of reality. You instantly get it, like that. Whereas with words, we don't get it. We don't ever quite get it. But how do we go from words to acceptance, etc.? Well, words are like taking little bites, little bites, little bites, little bites, little bites, adjusting, adjusting, and getting ready, getting ready, getting ready. And it's just a subtle little shift of willingness. It's a subtle shift of willingness where we're no longer interested in testing out the world, okay? We're no longer interested in data collecting, in testing it. Trials, tests, discovery, seeing, you know, how the flow of time, how time and space are rearranging themselves. We're no longer interested in the results of any of those experimentations. No longer interested in any data. Data, it becomes meaningless to us. So it's a subtle shift from wanting to collect more data, thinking that maybe that'll give you a better idea of how to make this mirage better so the child will be born. Shifting from that to data is meaningless. No more data. Not collecting any more data. Just a subtle little shift of willingness. That's what I've been told. That's what I've experienced. This is what my reason is telling me to. So we're going with that. It's just a subtle little tilt of willingness, just a little bit of willingness to where data collection is now entirely unimportant, totally irrelevant. Because there is no, because the being of everything is self-evident. It's completely self-evident. So there's no need to experiment on anything. There's no reason to run any trials, to tinker with anything, to, you know, do experimentations and write up results. I remember in school I hated science. Mathematics, science, anything that had to do with data, I absolutely hated it. I would have nothing to do with homework or doing anything like that. I said, what do you need data for? You know, everything is self-evident. It's self-evident. Just brush this aside. This is folly. This is nonsense. You're just working on the mirage. And nobody understood what I was talking about, so I went into, you know, deep funk, thinking like, wow. But there are people like that, you know, they just say, whoa. Data, what are you talking about? Data? Being is right here, right now. There's no data to collect. There's no absence of it ever. So what kind of data can you collect? It always is exactly as it is. There's no data, there's zero data. That's why I call it zero dimensionality. That's one way to describe God, zero dimensionality. It means zero data. There's no data to collect. So we make that little shift into being, to seeing being. And then what do? We're just seeing being. We see being everywhere. We realize there's nowhere where being is not. Nowhere. Nowhere in time or space. Nowhere in reality. It's omnipresent. It can't be anything other than that. Where can anything be except in the one omnipresence? The pure spaciousness, the everywhereness. Where can anything else be? Everything is here. Everything already is here. It's already being. There's nothing that doesn't have pure being. Everything is pure being. Everything is pure being. And there's only pure being, right? Forms, doom doesn't affect that in the slightest bit. But doom too is pure being. And so the importance of cycles and birth and death and no importance. None of it has any importance. The mirage has no, the dynamics of mirage have no more importance. No interest. They can still happen. You're totally disinterested. Totally disinterested. And all these scientists are measuring everything that's happening. Yeah, collecting data on everything that's happening. Utter folly. Yeah. They're trying to determine how come the child hasn't been born yet. We need to collect more data, more cowbell, to get this, so it'll work. So let's collect more data. Yeah, that's the motto of folly is let's collect more data. Okay, that is the height of insanity, height of folly, height of deception. Let's collect more data. And the problem is we are going into a phase now in this mirage constructing effort that we're engaged in, where this collect more data mantra of utter folly is the soup du jour for everybody here in this world. And that's entirely unpalatable, you know, to those who are wiser, who realize that they have zero interest in any data whatsoever. In fact, you can't collect any data on reality. It's impossible. There is no data. Reality is data free. Reality is entirely data free. Jesus should have said it's harder for a scientist to enter the kingdom of heaven than it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a scientist to enter the kingdom of heaven, because there's no data whatsoever. They'd say, well, there's nothing to do here. I can't collect any data. Everything is totally self-evident and exactly is what it is, always. Wow, no change in reality, no change in being. How can there be a change in being? How can we measure entrances and exits into everywhereness? There is no entrance. There are no entrances. There are no exits. There's zero data on that, right? How can we measure rising and falling of being? There is no rising and falling. There's zero data on that. The idea that these bursts of bodies and deaths are the rising of being and the falling of being is totally untrue. It's like dust in the air. You see dust go up in the air, down there, where it's still right in the air, right? It's still occupying. It's still entirely in space. Just as our thoughts are, everything that we're imagining is entirely still in everywhereness. There is no place other than everywhereness. So I've been able to do it several times, and it was simple. It's like just like a teeter-totter on a teeter-totter, and you just a little tip like this, and goes, oh, you know, a teeter-totter, if you just push a little bit, it goes like that, or push a little bit, tips like that, and then you say, oh my gosh, I got a different perspective. You go up, you know, you go up or down, you know, teeter-totter, and you got a different perspective. Say, oh my gosh, just a little willingness is all that it takes. Not a lot, just a little. As long as we equate data with value, you know, we're lost. We're a lost civilization. That's the problem with our civilization. Our civilization is the most regressive civilization almost imaginable. It's so regressive that we're equating data with value. Whereas what is valuable is seeing the holy vision of being. Of oneness, one being, one relationship, no data at all, no data to collect. That's what has value. Measuring a mirage has no value. But all we do, this world does, is take the measurements of this mirage and decorate it and work with it, and you know, it's just like, just spend all this time saying, oh God, what a wonderful mirage. Oh my gosh, look at this. You know, look at this animal. I mean, that stuff gets old in a hurry. You know, and I mean, childhood, we realize, this is all nonsense here. And yet, we're expected to be all, oh my God, look at this interesting bug, or oh, you know, whatever. It's like, oh, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? This is just a mirage, working on this crazy mirage of doom. And yet we're expected to, you know, take measurements. So no value, data has no value, none. No real value. We say it has value because it helps us keep working on the mirage, but the mirage has no value. So it doesn't really have any value. We can stop the work on the mirage right now, this very instant. And my prayer is for the entire universe to take a instant sabbatical from all work on the mirage. Everybody sit wherever they are. If you're driving side of the road, just lean back in your car. Wherever you are, sit back against a wall. Stop, you're walking along. Just sit on the ground. Everybody just stop what they're doing entirely. And just say, I don't need to work on the mirage at all. There's no need, because whatever is already here is totally sufficient to remind us of reality. We see the being of it all. We see the being of it all. Even if there was just empty space, we'd see the being of that too. So whatever appearance there is, whether it's tangible form or intangible, okay, that's sufficient to remind us of being, because we can see the being, we can experience the being of it right now, the eternal being of it right now. So may everybody just take a stop. The whole world stop. The whole world still. The whole universe just still. Absolute stillness in the entire universe. No one's working on the mirage anymore. It's ended. All the work is ended. And it will seem like that to us, those who see being everywhere. It will seem as if like all the work on the mirage is now ended. Even though people are still busy, you know, it won't seem like they're working on it anymore, because all we're seeing is the being. Nothing's happening to the mirage. Nothing's being added to the mirage. Nothing's being added or even subtracted. Completely meaningless. We will see the being of everything. So I think the way to enter into this, our little will, is to the will that the entire universe, may the entire universe simply stop working on the mirage this very instant. May the entire universe this very instant cease all work on the mirage, and in perfect stillness and quietness recognize the beingness that is all there is. maybe the entire universe cease all efforts of work on the horizon, measuring, whatever. All efforts cease this very moment. And we all accept just whatever we have right now in this universe is sufficient to perfectly remind us of reality, of the one relationship. And we see the being, the one being, all being as one right now. That's sufficient. It's sufficient. It's always sufficient. We don't have to do any more work on the mirage. Not a tiniest bit. So this is the mindset we're working towards. The important facet of it all is that everything without exception is being. So we don't have to fashion something else if we want to, but it's not like we say, oh, look at this, this is something beautiful. It's seeing that everything is in being, is being. It's the relationship it's important to see. It's the one relationship, and everything is it that is important to see for us. Not any particular beautiful thing or whatever has being, oh, this beautiful plant has being, or that. No, it's that everything, without any exception, equally. Because all this is just a mirage anyway. We worked on this mirage of impermanence, trying to create a child that didn't recognize permanence, eternal life, being. So all this stuff will turn to dust. It's all just dust, actually. But all that dust is being in pure everywhereness, total everywhereness, pure presence. Pure being, pure presence, omnipresence. So there's no place for anything else to be except here. There is no place except here. There is no place except here. Here is all there is. Here in the one pure space of everywhereness, where everything is. So we're the child now that needs to be, we're the child of remembrance. We're not going to ever give birth to a child that doesn't know its creator. It's impossible. And we can't give birth to a child that's separate from God's will. It's impossible. So we've deceived ourselves with this mirage. So now we are like the child, quote unquote child. We're the child of remembrance, where now we're remembering reality, remember being, remembering the one relationship. So we need, so actually the only, we're not really a child, but we go through a phase, a childish phase of remembrance, as it were, like, ah, I think I'm getting it, and now I'm starting to see all the, yeah, this, okay, I'm feeling it. And so we are the child that we've been waiting for, and the child is the child of remembrance, that we can never have a child of non-reality, never have a child of separate will. That's what we need to remember. We cannot create unlike the greater is impossible. So everyone stop this very moment. The cat just left here. There's another cat yowling over there. Everyone just stop and do nothing. You know, no attraction. to anything at all. No special attraction. No more special attraction. Drop all special work, special attraction for just a moment. The whole universe, just for a moment. So just imagine this, the entire universe. This place is totally free of all specialness for this moment. This area is totally free of all specialness. The city's all free of all, totally free of all specialness, special focus. This country is totally free of all special focus. This planet is totally free of all special focus. This galaxy, the solar system is totally free of all special focus. This galaxy, totally free of all special focus. This entire universe is totally free of all special focus. All universes totally free of all special focus. This very instant. And try to imagine that you dwell in a universe where this actually is taking place. This is taking place right now. And that's the holy instant. And that holy instant is the vision of oneness is born, as it were. So the holy instant has to be for all, everything, for all universes. Everything that arises, totally, everything stops for an instant. All focus on any specialness whatsoever. All endeavor on the mirage, all endeavor on specialness. For just a minute, just a second, just an instant, it all halts. So hold this imagination, as it were, this prayer in your mind, in your spirit, and say, yes, this is, I believe that this is going to happen for me. I am going to feel that this has happened for me. Because as they say, actually, each one of us carries the whole universe within us. It's our universe. So we can have this happen, actually, totally happen for us. But I don't like getting into all that metaphysical stuff. Really, I don't. Don't like it. I feel it's very distracting. We need to get at it intuitively, not to try and dissect it all out like that. No. It is enough to simply imagine that this could happen for you. Everything. All processes stop for an instant. All processes stop for an instant. Everything with a focus and specialness of some outcome, all stops. The whole work, all the work on the mirage stops for an instant. Entirely. We all take a break. We all say, we're going to stop and just be silent for a while. Everything. That is the birth of remembrance, where being is now seen. We've given ourselves the opportunity to see being. Okay, so this is a wonderful meditation to consider. Just see what it feels like to live in such a universe where everything stopped for you. Everything. All right. All right, very great, that's it.